Hello, statisticians. Mr. Youngsaber here from Skew the Script. Today we'll be talking about veterans' healthcare as well as a sampling distribution for a mean. Let's skew it. Today's lesson's on the sampling distribution for a mean. This is lesson 6.4 in our course sequence. In the United States, at events like football games, we have big public displays to honor our troops. Yet, when our troops return home from fighting, we don't always do the best job in truly honoring them. Here are some political cartoons post-World War I, Afghanistan, Vietnam, showing ways in which we as a civilian population may fail to serve the veterans who served us while fighting. And in addition to this, there's this sobering statistic, 17. That is the average number of US veterans' suicides per day. One would be too many. Unfortunately, we average 17. And many of these suicides are traced back to untreated PTSD and depression. In response to this problem, we'd hope that the United States would provide veterans with quick, high-quality mental health care to prevent some of these numbers. But unfortunately, that's not always the case. In 2014, there was a big scandal at the VA, Veteran Affairs Administration, which provides healthcare to veterans. Veterans couldn't get appointments at the VA for months, especially mental health appointments. After the scandal, in the wake of it, there was a new goal set by the VA. They set a goal of having an average wait time for mental health appointment for veterans of only 3 days with a standard deviation of 1 day. So what we're gonna do today is analyze as statisticians, has the VA now met its goal? If you want to follow along using guided notes, you can print them up at this URL. In order to analyze this topic, we first need to talk about the population mean versus the sample mean. So when you see mu, that means the population mean. It's a parameter, it's the mean among the whole population. Xbar represents the sample mean. It's a statistic measuring the mean among a sample drawn from the population. And you can use the sample mean to estimate the true population mean. Now, last lesson, you randomly sampled 4 VA clinics and got their wait times. This time, we're gonna randomly sample 30 VA clinics and find their mean wait time. So we went ahead and did that. And among the 30 VA clinics we randomly sampled, we found an average wait time of 5.33 days. So let's identify in this situation, these different terms. So in this case, the population that we're interested in is all VA clinics. And the parameter we want to estimate among that population is the true mean wait time. Has the VA met its goal that the average wait time among all its clinics is 3 days? In order to investigate that, we got a sample of 30 VA clinics because we couldn't measure all of them. So we got a sample of 30 VA clinics. And among them, we found that the sample mean wait time was 5.33 days. Note, that's higher than the 3 days that the VA is aiming for. So the question is this so high that we would start to doubt that the true mean wait time is actually 3 days? Or could it be that our sample happened to, by chance, get a few clinics that had unusually high wait times, and so our sample average was high, but among the whole population, the true mean wait time is actually 3 days? Well, we have to investigate using the sampling distribution for a mean. So in a world where the VA has actually achieved its goal, so in the world where the VA has a true mean wait time of 3 days, what sample mean wait times should we expect to see if we were to sample 30 clinics like we just did? In order to investigate this, we're gonna go to an applet that we've created to simulate the situation. So it's linked in the description, but here's the applet. We can see here that we have a population, and I'm gonna go ahead and set this to be a right skew population, assuming that some clinics are gonna have unusually high wait times, so we're gonna have a tail on the right. And we can see here that it's set to have the average wait time at 3 days with a standard deviation of 1 day. So this represents a population in which the VA has met its goal. Its true average wait time is 3 days with a standard deviation of 1 day. Now, I'm going to go ahead and sample 30 clinics from this population. I'm going to have one sample of 30 clinics. So this is simulating what it might look like to get all the wait times from those 30 clinics, and we can see them populating here. And then from these, we get a sample mean. And we can see here from the 30 clinics that I sampled, my sample mean actually happened to be exactly 3. So in this case, our sample mean matches the true population mean. Now that's not always going to happen. I can get another random sample, and by chance alone, it might vary above or below 3. So here's another sample of 30. And we can see here now, the sample mean was 2.8. So by chance, we happen to get some less wait time clinics, and the sample mean was 2.8. So I can do this a bunch of times. I'm at 100 such samples and simulate that. And we can see here, we get a distribution of sample mean wait times. It looks like it's centered at 3 of wait times we might expect to see on average, given our sampling procedure. And so that's what we mean by the sampling distribution for a mean. So to recap, we had a population distribution. This was all wait times from all VA clinics. And then we had a sampling distribution of means. So the population is data. It is the wait times from all the clinics at the VA. And then the means is a distribution of sample means. So we got a sample of 30 VA clinics, found their wait times, found the mean. That's one mean here. Another sample of 30 clinics, found their mean wait time. That's another mean here. And it's a collection of those means. And it turns out we can model the sampling distribution for means using a normal curve, specifically this normal curve. There's a couple of key features here. One is that this curve will be centered at the true population mean. So in a world where the true mean wait time is 3 days, if we get random samples, they will tend to be centered at that true mean wait time. So we're centered at 3 days, so our estimates are going to be unbiased. And then what's really useful here is we get a formula to see what the typical distance is between what our sample means might be and the true mean. Because we know by chance alone, any of these samples could sample more low wait time clinics than expected or more high wait time clinics than expected. So by chance, we're going to get some variation here. We're not going to get the true mean each time. So it's good to know how far spread out that's going to be by chance. So we have sigma, which is the standard deviation of the population values, but we really want to find sigma for our sampling distribution, which is the typical deviation between the sample means and the true mean. So we can plug in the sigma for the population and divide by the square root of the sample size, which in our case is 30. So we do 1/√30. And we see here that the standard deviation of our sampling distribution is 0.183. So what does that mean? It means that when we get a sample mean, it will typically vary from the true mean by about 0.183 days. So in a world where the VA has achieved its goal and has a mean wait time of 3 days among all its clinics, we'd expect that if we get a sample of 30 clinics, the sample mean would vary from that true mean by about 0.183 days. So it's gonna be very close to the true mean, because it'd be about 3.183 or 3 - 0.183, et cetera. So in this world where the true mean is assumed to be 3 days for the average wait time, would the sample mean we actually found earlier, 5.33 days, the one we got from the actual sample of 30 randomly chosen clinics, would that be surprising? I'm gonna graph that statistic here. And heck yeah, it'd be surprising. When we did the simulations, assuming this world, we found that the sample means tend to be centered at 3 with a standard deviation of only 0.183 days. It's a very tight distribution. We expect most of the sample means to be very close to 3 days. But the actual sample mean we got from our actual random sample was at 5.33 days. It's way bigger at 5 days. And so this might make me start to doubt that this assumption where we're assuming a world in which the average wait time is actually 3 days, that assumption might be wrong, because this is incredibly unusual. In fact, we can quantify how unusual it is. We can find the distance from the true mean. If we do 5.33 - 3, we see that we are 2.33 days higher than the assumed true mean of 3 days. Then we can divide by the standard deviation of our sample means. And when we divide that out, we get something like a z-score. And we find that we are 12.7 standard deviations above the true mean, 12.7. Remember that 3 standard deviations out is unusual. 12.7 standard deviations out is very unusual. And in fact, if you assume the normal curve, the probability of observing something like this, 12.7 standard deviations or higher above the mean, well, we could use table A, you could use your calculator to find that probability. it's going to be 0%, roughly 0%. It's just so unusual that that probability of getting that much higher than the mean or higher is about 0%. So that's making me start to doubt the claim that the true mean is 3 days, when the sample mean that we actually observed is so much higher than what we'd expect under that claimed true mean. So this analysis helped us determine whether or not the claim of the VA of a mean wait time of 3 days was credible. And we found out we are actually doubting it given the sample mean that we got. So in order to do this analysis, we do need to check some conditions. And we're gonna go through those right now. What are those conditions? Well, we found that the sample means would be centered at the true mean. This is proved by the random condition, which shows that you have an unbiased center. There's a 10% condition, which shows that you'll have a calculable spread. You can use this formula for your standard deviation of the sampling distribution. And then finally, there's a normal slash large sample assumption, which shows that you can use a normal shape to model the sampling distribution. So condition one, the random condition, we must obtain a random sample. If we obtain a random sample, we know that our sample means are going to be centered at the true mean. We're going to have an unbiased estimate. Now imagine we didn't do a random sample. Instead, we sent a survey to each VA clinic asking for their wait time. So we're doing a voluntary response sample. Only ones that want to respond will respond. We're going to get biased estimates because clinics with long wait times probably won't respond. We're only going to hear from the short wait times clinics. And so our sample mean is going to tend to vary lower than the true mean. And this is going to give us biased estimates. So we need to make sure we get a random sample. Condition two is a 10% condition. We need our sample size to be less than 1/10 of the population size. And that will ensure that our calculation of the spread for our sampling distribution is true. And it's too much math to go into at the moment. You don't necessarily need to know the math behind this for the AP exam. But if you want to see a related explanation, go to lesson 6.3 in our course sequence. Now, condition three is the normal slash large sample condition. The population distribution must be normal, or your sample size must be 30 or more to assume that the sampling distribution is roughly normal. Let's show what you mean. So imagine that the population of wait times was actually normal, not right skewed, but normal. Now imagine that we got a bunch of samples of n equals two sample size. So we sampled two clinics, got their mean wait time, put that down. Two clinics, got the mean wait time, put that down. That sampling distribution of means would look like this. We do the same thing with sample size 10. So sample 10 clinics, find the mean wait time, write that down, et cetera. We get a distribution of means that looks like this. And then finally, a sample size of 30 like we actually did. What you'll notice here is that the sampling distribution, the distribution of means, is approximately normal for all sample sizes. Now, let's look at a skewed population. This is the right skewed population. If we get a sample of two clinics, we're going to notice that our sampling distribution now appears to have some skew. So again, we're sampling two clinics, we're finding the mean, and then we're writing it down. Sometimes we're going to sample two clinics that are very high on the skew, and we're going to get a very high sample mean. And so the sample means are going to show that skew. So the sampling distribution will have some skew if we have that low of a sample size. Now, if we get a sample size of 10, that skew is reduced because with samples of 10, we're going to get some high ones, but ideally we're going to get some low ones in that sample because they're high sample size. And so the skew is reduced, but it's still there. It's only when we get a sample size of 30 or above that we see that the sampling distribution looks more normal. And that's because even if we do get some high outlier wait times in our sample, we're going to get some from the low end and it's going to cancel out. We're going to get some pretty normal looking mean estimates. So there's no visible skew when we have a high sample size. So the central limit theorem is the key part of this. It states that when n is large, when your sample size is large, the sampling distribution is approximately normal. And that's useful because we never know the population shape. We're trying to estimate something in the population. We don't know the population. And that's okay if we don't know the population shape, because if we have a high enough sample size, we can say, hey, our sampling distribution is approximately normal, and we can still make estimates about the mean using our sample. So again, as a summary, here are the conditions and here are the different things they prove for modeling the sampling distribution for a mean. So putting it all together, let's check our conditions. Again, we're trying to investigate whether the VA has a 3-day average wait time among all its clinics. So we randomly sample 30 clinics. Now, one, random. The sample of 30 VA clinics was selected randomly. So we're good there. We're going to get unbiased estimates. Two, 10%. Is it reasonable to assume that 30, the amount of clinics we sampled, is less than 10% of all the number of all VA clinics? And we assume that there are probably more than 300 VA clinics in the country. So yes, that is a reasonable assumption. So we have a calculable spread. And finally, normal slash large sample. The sample size is large. So regardless of where the population is normal or skewed, we have a sample size of 30 or more. It's actually 30. So we're going to be good to go on having a roughly normal distribution by the central limit theorem. So finally, we're going to end today with our discussion. You may have noticed that the sampling distribution tends to get more narrow as the sample size increases. So you can see here, the sampling distribution is shrinking in width when we get a higher sample size per sample. Why does this occur? I want you to explain and explore using A, the simulation. So go back to the simulation and explore using that. And then B, using the formula for the sampling distribution, especially the spread part of that formula. Why do you think this is occurring? That's all for today, statisticians. We'll discuss this in class. We'll see you next time.